competition in the United States, and we come to you live because right now, Evelyn Ashford, who holds the world record 10.79, who won this morning, won her first round heat, is getting set now in the second round. I'm Al Michaels, along with Wilma Rudolph, who won three gold medals in the 1960 Olympics. We watch Ashford here in lane 7. Angela Bailey in lane 6 is another contender in this race. Lillian Gachet and Heidi Gogel in lanes 5 and 3, respectively, are also to be watched. Top four will advance to tomorrow's semifinals. And from the start, it is Evelyn Ashford in lane 7. Out in front immediately, it is Ashford out in front of the rest of the field. And Evelyn will go on to the semifinals if she wins it. It appears that Bailey wound up second and Heidi Gogel of West Germany finishes third. Unofficially, her time 11.22, her world record clocking 10.79, so she was not tested today as Evelyn wins her second race of the day, Wilma.
Right, well, I knew she wouldn't be tested this second time because I think the thing is, coming out the first time, you're the most frightened. After you run the first race, you sort of have it in hand. And I think the thing that made the difference in the time is not to have a Heather Oaks run next to you. They're off. They're getting ready now. They're on their marks. Evelyn is out. She has a really good start. You can tell that her confidence is there. She's beginning to pull from the very beginning on her first, I would say after her first 10 steps. She's well on her way. She's looking good. Very good form all the way to the finish line. Very relaxed. Good time, especially for a semi.
And she is presently acknowledging the cheers of this huge crowd at the Los Angeles Coliseum on a hot day. I believe the temperature is probably still up over the 90-degree mark. Let's isolate on her now.
Right, she's very good position. Very good start. If you notice, that first foot is still just a little bit off, but the confidence is coming. She's off. Her style is good. She's running very easy. She's running very relaxed. She's getting ready now to pull away, and this is where Evelyn accelerates. I would say after the first 20 yards, her speed just becomes faster and faster. I think the farther she runs, the faster she becomes.
Well, this was the first heat of four in this second round. Alice Brown and Jeanette Bolden have yet to run as they attempt also to join Evelyn Ashford in the semifinals and the finals, which will take place here tomorrow. So Evelyn Ashford, 27 years old, who lives here in Los Angeles now, begins our coverage tonight with a victory in the 100-meter dash at the Coliseum. A look at the big crowd as our coverage of the Olympic Games continues.
Summer weekend like this one, hundreds of thousands of Los Angelinos would normally be headed for the beaches, jamming the freeways, filling the air with fumes. But on this particular weekend, the big crowds are filling the Olympic venues, particularly the Coliseum, where track and field moves into high gear. From Los Angeles, California, ABC Sports presents the games of the 23rd Olympiad. Hello, I'm Jim McKay. This is the day of Carl Lewis' debut in an Olympic final, but it's also the day of the American male gymnasts in their final appearance, the final day of competition for Mary T. Maher and the other great swimmers of the world. We've seen Evelyn Ashford already. Another look at Edwin Moses, the American half-milers in second-round action, along with Britain's Sebastian Coe and Steve Ovette, and so much more today and this evening. Now, Al Michaels is at the Coliseum for track and field. Let's check in with him first.
Well, Jim, we had a crowd of close to 70,000 this morning. They expect almost 90,000. Every seat may be full tonight. It's a big night of track and field. What happened this morning, among other things, Tom Petronoff, the former world record holder in the javelin, did qualify, a member of the United States team, of course. Also, Duncan Atwood was right on the edge, but he became the 12th and last qualifier to go into the javelin final tomorrow. All of the American runners who should have advanced did so. No surprises there. Now, tonight we have already seen Evelyn Ashford in action. And still to come, of course, will be Carl Lewis. We'll be taking a look at him, hopefully twice for Lewis's sake, in the semifinals. And then if he makes his way into the finals later on as he seeks gold in the 100-meter dash. Mike Conley of the University of Arkansas, the top qualifier in the triple jump yesterday. He and Willie Banks going into their final event tonight. And then Edwin Moses tries to stretch his winning streak to 104. All of that coming up from the Coliseum.
This is Jack Whitaker at Pauley Pavilion, where tonight we have the men's individual competition. Gold, silver, and bronze medals will be won tonight in all six of the apparatuses on which the men perform. In the floor exercise, look for Bart Connors leading the United States, having scored a 9.95 in the compulsory exercise. On the pommel horse, Peter Widmar, the all-around silver medalist, will be among the favorites. He scored a perfect 10 on this apparatus in the compulsories. At the still rings, Li Ning, the personable young Chinese, scored a 10 on the rings in the optional exercise. Mitch Gaylord of the United States will face tough opposition on the vault, but is capable of winning yet another medal for the United States. On the parallel bars, the all-around gold medalist, Koji Gushikin of Japan, has been consistency itself. He has scored 2.99. And Koji's teammate, Shinju Morisue, has been not only consistent, he has been perfect on the horizontal bar with 2.10 scored in the compulsories and optionals. Lots of medals, lots of high-power performances tonight at Pauley Pavilion.
Howard Cosell here at the boxing venue as the parade of American victories continues tonight. You'll see the brilliant light flyweight Paul Gonzalez in his second bout of the competition, an early victory over a very difficult South Korean opponent, and then you'll meet again the light heavyweight Evander Holyfield, favored to win the gold in his division.
I'm Jim Lampley. Competition comes to a close in swimming tonight, and Americans are favored to pad their gold medal total of 18 to at least 21, which would equal the all-time high set at Mexico City. George DiCarlo is favored to add the 1,500-meter gold medal to the one he already won in the 400-meter freestyle, and the men's medley relay team ranks as at least a slight favorite in what could be a sensational battle with the Australians, the Canadians, and the West Germans. But much of the focus here will be on two individual world record holders. Canadian Alex Bauman will try to add the gold medal in the 200-meter individual medley to the one he won in the 400-meter race. It would be Canada's fourth. They went 72 years without a swimming gold medal prior to these games. And American world record holder Mary T. Maher will go for her third gold medal of the games in the women's 200-meter butterfly. So the focus will be on Bauman, Maher, and the American gold medal total as swimming comes to a close.
The games of the 23rd Olympiad are being brought to you by Kodak, official film of the 1984 U.S. track and field team. Kodak film, because time goes by. Budweiser, proud sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team. For all you do, this Bud's for you. Allstate, for home, auto, business, health, and life, you're in good hands with Allstate. And local McDonald's restaurants, who joined together to build the Olympic Swim Stadium.
Feel like you're part of the Olympic action. Play McDonald's. When the U.S. wins, you win Olympic game.
What's that, Mom?
Basketball.
The U.S. wins.
Then we win.
When the U.S. wins a medal in the event on your game card, you win a Big Mac. Or regular fries. Or regular Coca-Cola. Or win up to $10,000 instantly. So go to McDonald's and collect your game cards. Because when the U.S. wins, you win.
Way to go, Mom.
Olympic stars can start out like this. So catch them now with a Kodak disc.
I'm gonna get you with the Kodak disc. As sure as shooting, I'm not gonna miss. Not when it's as easy as this.
I'm gonna get you with the Kodak disc.
The Kodak disc camera advances automatically and knows when to flash. Think there's a camera easier than that? Not by a long shot.
You're never too small to give it your all.
I'm gonna get you with the Kodak disc.
Kodak, official sponsor of the U.S. Olympic team.
My dad's a hero.
Yeah?
He fixed the whole house with Stanley.
Stanley who?
Stanley Hardware. He helped Mom put up plant hangers, put a chain lock on a door to keep bears out.
Stanley shelves for my room, and safety latches so my sister can't get the scissors. She's just a kid.
He put magic spray hinges on our door.
It closes by itself. I'm telling my dad.
Get a $2 rebate from Stanley on the magic spring hinge at participating stores.
Time. It takes time to create quality. The quality taste of Budweiser.
Time to select the choicest ingredients. For exclusive Beechwood aging, to brew the distinctively clean, crisp taste of Budweiser. Quality taste. That's what people want in a cold glass of beer. And this is the one they want. Somebody still cares about quality.
Sixty-four years ago, after the American Charlie Paddock won the Olympic 100 meters, somebody called him the world's fastest human. Well, ever since, the winner of that event in each Olympics has been awarded that unofficial title. What a litany of great names they've been, really. Harold Abrahams, he of Chariots of Fire fame in 1924. Little Eddie Tolan running with his glasses taped to his head here in L.A. in 1932. Jesse Owens in Berlin and Bob Hayes in Tokyo. And Jim Hines setting a world record that stood for 15 years in Mexico City. The event's thought of as an American specialty, so it really comes as something of a surprise to realize that no American has won it in 16 years. The Soviet Valery Bortsov swept both sprints in 1972. Hazley Crawford of Trinidad and Tobago won at Montreal. And, of course, the U.S. didn't participate in 1980. Now comes Carl Lewis, entourage and all, heralded with everything but trumpets as the new king, the new Owens, the invincible, the unbeatable. Is he really all these things? Well, the test begins this evening, really, with the semifinals and then the final of the 100 meters. Right now, however, we're in the process of trying to find out who is the world's fastest woman. Right, Al?
That's right, Jim. I liked the way you put it, too. In a way, I think I referred to this yesterday, the 100 meters is the great American race, but you put it so well. It's been a number of years since 1968 since we've had a male winner. It's also been that long since we've had an American woman win the 100-meter dash. Wyoming Tyus was the last to do it. Now, we've seen Ashford qualify. Here is Alice Brown now in this heat. This is the third of four heats. The top four finishers will advance to tomorrow's semifinals. Yeah. Alice Brown, who ran 11.15 this morning out of lane four. And it's a very good start for Alice Brown. It's Alice Brown out in front of the field. It is Brown with Marjama of Finland in lane three in second place. And it's Brown winning it. Marjama lines up second. Heather Oaks of Great Britain finishes third. So, an 11.35 for Alice Brown, who of course runs in the shadow of the heralded and highly publicized Evelyn Ashford, the world record holder. But Alice has been very much holding her own, looked very strong in her heat this morning. Competed in the World Championships at Helsinki, Wilma Rudolph, and she has to be quite happy with her performance today.
Oh, I think she's quite happy. She's worked very hard. You can tell she always turns around and looks to see what happens time-wise. But she has an excellent start. She always gets a fantastic start. And she's out, and she's already running smooth. If you can look right now, she's running relaxed. Her knees are up, her arms are pumping. She has complete control. I was thinking that since Oaks was in the race with her, that it would be a closer race. But I think they have to be a little closer together from the standpoint of lane assignment.
Now, they're
a
the
great
top,
finish.
The top three, we called them for you, Marjama and Oaks. And finishing fourth in lane seven was Juliet Cuthbert. And that's significant because she, too, now advances. Also, I think it's significant to note a 2.3 meters per second headwind. That's a pretty big headwind for these ladies in this heat.
If you notice, she's concentration is there. If you notice, her first step is good. Excellent first step, and she's driving out. And this is all of the power in those first 5 to 10 steps. And once she straightens up a little bit and really gets into the race, her form is excellent. She looks fantastic. She runs very easy. I think she will really do well by the next race going. Her confidence is building each time. And the thing about Alice Brown is she's hungry. She's determined. And in a race that is so short, there's no pre-planning. The thing is trying to always get a good start and maintaining. And she did exactly that in this race here.
And here's a lady who might have quit. She won the trials in 1980, and because of the boycott, did not get to go to Moscow naturally. Thought about retiring, but here she is now on her way to the semifinals at the age of 23, her home nearby in Altadena. So we've seen Evelyn Ashford, and we have seen Alice Brown, and there are the results, the top four that advanced to the semifinals in the women's 100.
It isn't easy keeping in shape, but Don Gwaltney isn't doing this just for his health. He's doing